right, welcome back to the Rock Stop. Chris Contra here. And now we're going to have some fun because on the phone line, I have a very special guest, the very lovely and talented Kelly Maroney. How you doing, Kelly?
Hi, Chris. How are you?
Doing good, doing good.
Thanks for asking me.
Oh, absolutely. Big fan of your work for quite a while, so this is a great honor to have you here on the Rock Stop with me.
Well, thank you so much.
Right off the bat, of course, a lot of people want to talk about Chopping Mall. I've been hearing from a lot of people. I want to hear about Chopping Mall, and we will get to that.
Okay.
But first, I just want to ask you, when did you know acting was for you?
You know, I think I always wanted to be an actress. Either an actress, a princess, or the Virgin Mary. Those are the three games I played.
Right.
When I was little. I briefly kind of thought maybe I want to be a vet, but I just always wanted to be an actor. I think I was just born that way.
Right.
You know, I don't think I could control it.
Yeah, I understand that. So, like, who were some of your influences in acting that...
Well, see, I watched old movies with my mom. That was a huge bonding thing.
I just think that
something that she got so much pleasure out of, I also was absorbing that information, too. And I just thought, what a great thing to be able to do. So I would have to say Bette Davis.
Uh-huh.
Of course.
Yes.
She's the queen. And Susan Hayward.
Right.
Who did all those B movies. Gosh, she was really good. She did all those B movies. And every time we turned on the television at one point, there she was.
Yeah.
And, let's see who else. Those are the big two that spring to mind from that experience.
What's your favorite Bette Davis movie?
Dark Victory?
Oh, okay.
Maybe? It's hard to say.
Yeah.
But whatever happened to Baby Jane, of course.
Of course, yeah. That's got to be my favorite. I like some of her more... I like when she did a lot of horror movies. The Nanny, have you ever seen that movie?
Yes.
Yeah, that was very good.
We watched Hush, Hush, Sweet Charlotte before we watched Whatever Happened to Baby Jane. But so, you know, that's a weird thing to have some of your earliest memories be. So,
I suppose that would be.
I have a great memory of her shooting a gun. No, and torturing somebody with my earliest memories. I sure wanted to do that too.
Yeah, right. Yeah, so she was one of your big influences.
Yes.
Yeah.
I just always thought it was great to have the focus be on a person's talent and skill as opposed to their appearance.
Right.
Because, I can't compete, you know, the looks department and all that stuff. And I just thought,
I don't know if I agree with that, but.
Well, thank you very much. I mean, it's just fun to play different people all the time.
Yes.
Instead of being the girl.
And you certainly have played a wide range of characters throughout your illustrious career. I mean, you started in soap operas, correct?
Uh-huh. I'm so lucky. The first couple parts I played, I was a bad person.
Right.
So I thought, okay, I guess I'm going to be the delinquent, the psychotic killer. You know, that's fine with me. I fell right into that niche right away.
Uh-huh.
Much to my surprise, when I got to California, I was the cheerleader. I couldn't get over it. How could I be, you know, a psychopath in New York and then get to Los Angeles and I'm the cheerleader? I don't know what that says about those two cities. But that really shocked me. I mean, we don't never know how we're coming across to other people.
Yeah.
You know, so I was perfectly happy. I was playing evil people and murderers and stuff. And but, you know, to me, acting is acting.
Right.
I mean, there are things you have to adjust for the stage, things that are different about the way you shoot television as opposed to film. But the kernel of it is the same thing.
Yeah. Now, speaking of shooting, like you did the soap opera Ryan's Hope, which I think you did like over 300 episodes of that. Is that correct?
Yeah. Well, I had a 3-year contract.
Right. And now, like that. Well, I was just going to say, because that schedule must have been kind of grueling. I mean, soap opera.
It was a great way to learn because it was grueling. I mean, sometimes we do 6 shows in 5 days.
Yeah, wow.
You know, slick, we called that a 6-pack. And you just never know what was. Sometimes you get your scripts the week before, and they put them in your. You had a little mailbox like you could have at an office, and you find out what you were going to be doing that week, and you'd either have a whole bunch of scenes, or maybe you had a light week. I remember one storyline. I was in a coma, and all I had to do is come in and get in bed. It was awesome. But mostly I was yakety yakety yakking. So we get there at 7 o'clock. We do a rehearsal, then we go do whatever we needed to do, set things up, because we'd all start going right to blocking, and then they camera block it. And so people who worked at the network always say, I remember watching you guys camera block, and all you guys are in your bathrobes and your rollers, and, so, and everyone through the whole network can see you do that. And then they have a break, and then you have a this, they don't do this anymore, but they shot it like a play. Then we had a run-through, a dress rehearsal, and a tape. And it was so fun because we had this completely almost stereotypical stage manager. His name was Briggsy, and he was amazing. And when you hear his voice go, cameras and booms, please, cameras and booms, this is the air show. It was just like opening night.
Wow.
They don't have that now. It was amazing.
Wow.
And then so the camera would shoot it in sequence. Like if you were up first, the cameras would go up, you'd play your scene. Then the cameras, the lights would go down, the camera would move, you could hear it whirring, that whirring sound. And it would go all the way around the room, and lights would go up in a different place, and they'd play their scene. And then the camera followed you around, you just stayed in your set, and then when the lights went up, you started talking. And then when you're done, the lights went out.
Yeah. Wow.
It was really something. And I mean, usually what they do is they call people in for blocks, and they get them all ready, and they block it and tape it now.
Yeah.
So, and that's another thing, too, is you really get to know all the people on the show that way.
Right.
I don't know if you get to know everybody now.
I know, right. You that's know. A good point, yeah. So it was a great learning experience for you.
Well, that's thank you for bringing me back to my point there. That's how I learned how to act, because with anything, it's all practice. And who has the opportunity practice every day? You know, here's a little comedy, Kelly. Oh, now do you mind crying for 2 weeks?
Yeah, right.
Okay. Now here I want you to take drugs and fall off this building. Oh, okay. You're going to be pregnant now.
Yeah.
You
right.
have to roll with all this stuff.
That's very true. Yeah.
I never, ever, ever could have gotten a grasp on technique the way I did if I didn't have the opportunity to do that every day.
Yeah, that's great.
That's the luckiest thing in the world.
Right, totally. Now, so one of your first earlier movie roles you ever did was one of the biggest comedies of all time, I think, Fast Times at Ridgemont High, which you were really great in. And so what was that like? Was that like your first movie?
It was my second movie, actually. I got a movie called Slayground, which I played a psychotic killer in, with Peter Coyote. And it was a smaller part. I just foreshadowed the Peter Coyote was the killer, and I foreshadowed him.
Uh-huh.
And that didn't come out for a while. So actually, Fast Times came out before that.
So that was the first movie that was released, I guess.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Which was a huge movie.
Kind of fast, too. It was in... I don't know. I always had the feeling that there was magic on that set.
Oh, I could imagine.
And I was thinking, you know, it's probably just because you'd never been to California before. But there just was. I mean, I think everybody was, you know, we're so serious about what we were doing. And
yeah. And that's why I think it remains such a classic.
Sean was in character the entire movie. Yeah, I mean, that's what he did.
Yeah.
When we did that scene where we go to the morgue with Mr. Vargas.
Right.
And he pulls out the thing as the human heart.
Uh-huh.
I actually went and read some cadaver books.
Right.
So I would know what I was actually looking at for that scene. We were really serious. There was not anybody there that wasn't completely devoted to what we were doing.
I think that's so important in why that movie is remained, you know, such a loved movie, is because everybody really gave their all to it. And like you said, that cadaver scene, that wasn't only a comedy. It had some serious topics in there. I mean...
Well, that's just it. Years to do about it, they said, this isn't necessarily a funny movie, and there's an abortion in it.
Yeah, right.
In 1982. And I remember getting a phone call saying, you know what, they might not release our movie.
Wow.
And I was they better, you know, I was devastated. Yeah. But they did. But they, it was a different thing. And you know what? Now we're in the Library of Congress, so go figure.
Absolutely.
You don't know. No one knows anything.
Do you remember the first time you saw that? Did you have like a big viewing party with everybody, like all your friends and family?
No, I was so bummed out. I had gone back to do Ryan Tope for another year.
Oh, okay.
And I said, you know, because I was going to shoot some more scenes. They asked me to be available for more scenes for Fast Times. And I said, I really want to do that. And I'm going to be super upset if I don't get to do it. And they said, oh, no problem. We'll move heaven and earth to get you back there. Well, they didn't. So I feel like a red eye to do that first shot of, you know, when they're playing We Got the Beat.
Yeah.
The first shot. And that's all the extra stuff I got to do. They were going to do me and my boyfriend breaking up at the end.
Oh, that's too bad.
Yeah. I was really, really bummed about it. But when it came out, I was in New York. I didn't go to the rap party. I didn't get any of that. I was so upset about it. But, you know, working is working. Actors are going to be grateful when they have a job.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah, I understand that.
You learn harsh lessons when you're a kid and you don't necessarily understand how to be mature about it. I was thinking, everybody's having fun but me. I don't think I saw it right away. Oh, wait a second. I wonder... I think in the dailies, I started to see in the dailies. I remember being very honored because when they showed that scene in the assembly, Sean was sitting there and he went, that was awesome. I was like, I'm so complimented because, you know, he's so serious.
Yeah.
For him to like something that you did was amazing. And then when Night of the Comet came out, he got a message to me that he liked it, really liked the movie.
Awesome. So. Yeah, that's cool. You were the head cheerleader, I guess, in that movie, right?
Cindy Carr, yes.
Yeah. The other cheerleader in that was Pamela Springsteen?
Pam Springsteen, yes.
Right. Now, she went on to do some horror movies.
She doesn't do conventions or anything like that. She's a photographer now,
okay.
And she really doesn't have any truck with the horror movie stuff.
Not anymore.
No. I mean, if you're going to go into a different field, it's really distracting. You're trying to, you know.
Yeah.
Hey, aren't you the girl? And, you know, I mean, it's really distracting. I don't blame her one bit.
Mm-hmm. Did you bond with her on the side? Who was like the...
Yeah, she's a fantastic person. I really, really felt like we got to be super close friends.
Cool.
But the people who were working together... Or actually were the ones that got to be friends. Like, I mean, Phoebe and Jennifer got to be really close.
Uh-huh.
We shot it for a long time. I mean, it wasn't just like one of those 3-week shoots. It was a long time. So we sort of fell into that social pattern, I think, a little bit.
So let me ask you this. So we want to get to Chopping Mall. Was this...
Chopping Mall. Who thought I'd be talking about Chopping Mall decades later? Everyone wants to know about Chopping Mall.
I'm telling you, I've gotten...
And I just can't believe it.
I've gotten more questions about that movie than... I mean, it is a great movie. I think it mixed horror and comedy and adventure. I kind of had it all. So Jim Wynorski directed it, and you worked with him a number of times. So how was he to work with?
He's a whole different experience. He's kind of in a Wynorski movie, Wynorski is the star of the Wynorski movie. I mean, if you'll notice it, it's all about him. So he's a Leo, so he's like really bombastic and he yells and screams if things aren't going well. Like, all he really wants to do is have people on their game and be doing their job. So if you do that, then he could be a lot of fun, too.
Yeah.
We had such a great time on Chopping Mall, even though it was the middle of the night and we were exhausted. And the mall kept they were freaking out because we were ruining everything. They would close, and then we'd go in there and shoot while they were closed. And then we had to have everything put back the way it was for them to open in the morning.
Wow.
So that was, I mean, I know, I don't even know how the crew did that.
Yeah, wow. So where that was in California, a mall in California?
It was the Galleria,
okay.
which was the mall film mall of the 80s.
Mm-hmm.
Some other malls actually stood in for the Galleria. However, that was really the Galleria, as it was in past times, too. They've since torn it down and they rebuilt it, but it's completely different.
Oh, yeah.
Anything like what you... So people come and they want to see the Galleria and they go, wait a second, that's not what I came to see.
Uh-huh. Yeah, that's got to be a letdown. Would you say Chopping Mall, because it certainly seemed that way, that it was your most physically demanding role, or?
Yes, well, I also did a cult, if you can get more of a cult film than Chopping Mall. I did it super, I have to laugh when I talk about my career, I'm sorry. The Zero Boys, which some people have actually seen, came out on Blu-ray, where I was running around like an idiot through the woods for the whole movie. So fortunately for me, when I started running around in the mall, I knew how to do the running with the dolly, the camera dolly.
Yeah.
Because if I hadn't, everyone would have had kittens. We had to go really fast. There was no time for me to be blowing shots.
Right.
You know, but you got to like sort of run in slow-mo, but make it look like you're really running your butt off. But the camera can't go that fast, and you can only go as fast as the camera can move. And the DP, if you blow that shot, will get really angry. Because, you know, like, it's a lot of work to set that shot up and everything.
Oh,
so
yeah.
It's really a technique of you have to run super slow so that you don't outrun him. But it has to look like you're really booking.
Yeah.
I already knew how to do that, so... I was really relieved. Yeah. But yeah, I mean, I had so much fun running and being physical. I mean, sometimes acting can just sort of sit in your trailer, go to craft service, put on 5 pounds, you know,
right.
Talking heads. So I have a really good time when I get to run around. So.
Yeah, that's,
to this day,
awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, some of the scenes I remember that were very memorable is a tarantula. You were in the pet shop or whatever, and
yeah, that was Dolores. there's a bug wrangler, right?
Okay.
And we call them wranglers. So there's a gun wrangler and there's a bug wrangler, and those are professional bugs. And so the guy comes up to me and he says, you know, because he didn't want me to get scared of her or anything. He said, "This is Dolores. She's been in the business for years, worked with all the greats," and he just humanized them for me.
Yeah.
So, you know, while it's not my idea of a good time, like having snakes and spiders crawl on me, it really was okay. I was happy the scene was over, but it wasn't the worst thing that could have happened. I know people who are, if you're scared of spiders or scared of snakes, yeah, that would have been horrible, but I'm not, I don't have those phobias. Fortunately.
Right.
So there was supposed to be a scorpion in there, but when Orsky had said, "I'm not going to have," because I'm, you know, hanging off buildings and all that stuff in the harness, he said, "I'm not going to ask you to do anything I wouldn't do myself."
Uh-huh.
And so they dropped the scorpion in his lap, and he went, "No scorpion."
Yeah.
I have to work, because it was a big sucker, too.
Yeah,
it was like a little guy. It was a big sucker. I think it was deep poison, the guy said, but, you know.
Yeah, it's still a scorpion.
No scorpions.
Yeah, I can understand that. So, of course, like I said, you did so many great movies in all genres. I mean, I remember that the one you did with Joe Mantegna. That was really good. Face Down.
Oh, thanks. Most people have not seen that. Yeah.
Yeah.
One of
yeah,
my
I mean,
favorite
it's
movies I ever did.
Yeah. It's.
I mean, I got to play a schizophrenic.
Right.
You know, and I love noir with all my heart. I love those kind of movies.
Yeah.
So to be able to be in one, I mean, we almost shot that black and white, but then Showtime said, nobody watches a black and white movie. That's a hard, much harder sell.
Mm-hmm.
But originally, you know, that would have been cool.
Yeah, yeah.
But it's pretty in color.
Right. I mean,
it was working with.
Yeah, I was just gonna say, black and white movies, I can't understand how people don't. I mean, I love black and white movies.
I love them. It's a whole different skill set to shoot a black and white, too.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, it's... Well, I mean, I get excited when I see an old movie, so, yeah, black and white's
yeah.
fine with me. But most people...
Yeah, I guess most people. Yep. And, yeah, Face Down. I mean, it was great, so... I guess it all worked out.
Yeah, so, well, they colorized black and white movies, too, which is a whole different conversation that we don't need to get into. But
yeah, well,
and also it was...
I was just going to say, what are your feelings on that colorization?
Well,
just as a quick maybe thing.
You know, I think it was intended to be black and white.
Right.
I never want to stunt somebody's creativity if they want to mess around with stuff.
Yeah.
But I mean, you also have to respect the original person, what they were going after.
Absolutely.
I mean, they shot, you have to light and shoot way differently for black and white than you do with color. So even when they colorize it, it looks kind of flat.
Yeah, I agree.
Because it wasn't meant to be that way.
Yep.
But I don't know. You know, anything that gets people to watch good movies, if colorizing them gets them to watch good movies, okay.
Yeah, ultimately, the movie is what is important, so yeah.
Yeah, I mean, we all get so serious about it, but it is entertainment, you know?
Yep. I hear that.
Not out there saving lives. Although, you know what? Many people have said, you know, I saw that, or happened to catch that movie at an important time in my life, and it really changed things for me. So,
oh, definitely. Yeah, I could. I've had movies in my life that saw them at the right time and really made sort of a difference. So, yeah, movies are very important, I think.
Well, it's the catharsis experience. I mean, that's what attracted me to acting, although I couldn't have told you that at the time. But it's,
yeah,
you know, you cry with them. I mean, movies that are mirrors, they reflect people back to themselves. And they make people feel like somebody else feels that way, too.
Yep.
And, you know, like Night of the Comet, people want to believe that if there was an apocalypse, even though you were a doofus, you would survive somehow.
Yeah, Night of the Comet, by the way, another terrific movie, sci-fi, with elements of horror in there, and is that probably the movie you get asked about more than maybe even Chopping Mall?
I'd say it's a toss-up between Chopping Mall and Night of the Comet.
Really?
And, you know, I thought I was going to be the serious actress and stuff.
Yeah, but these movies, became... like cult classics, whether they're critically acclaimed or not, cult classics, I think, are just as important as the big critically acclaimed movie.
I do too.
Yeah.
I do too. And it's connecting with people on a much more personal level.
Right.
You know, I mean, I just feel like it's a much more intimate experience being a cult person.
Right, exactly. And, I was going to say about Night of the Comets, some of the scenes I remember, one that just came to mind real quick was, of course, the famous scene between you and, I believe it was your stepmother, Doris, who she slapped you, then you slapped her, and then she punched you.
Right.
I got to say, the those slaps looked pretty authentic to me. That was done very well.
Sharon was really, she didn't want to do it, you know, the last thing she wanted to do was deck me, but I had the experience on Ryan's Help of getting into physical fights with the woman who played my mother, and what we found is, you know, be late at night, everyone wanted to go home, and you couldn't get this dang shot because it doesn't look real. And finally Louise said to me, just hit me, Kelly, just hit me, I really want you to, you know, it ends up being more painful to do those fake slaps and have to keep doing it over and over and over again.
Yeah.
And you can kind of sell it with the momentum of your arm.
Yeah.
And really hit. I mean, and so I said to Sharon, I said, it's going to hurt worse. Just hit me, Sharon.
Wow.
Just hit me. And she's like, no. I said, seriously, just hit me. Because otherwise we'd still be there.
Yeah.
It doesn't look real. I mean, you
can't. I got to say, yeah, right. Those did look authentic. I always thought that. And, I mean, I even think of like one of the greatest movies of all time, The Godfather. There's a scene where James Caan is fighting, I think it was Talia Shire's boyfriend or husband or something. And some of those punches did not look as authentic as those slaps did in Night of the Comet. I got to say it.
Well, because they probably weren't punching each other.
Yeah, I mean.
They really work on it, too. I mean, to get, you know, stunt people in there to teach you how to do it, and there's a whole, I mean, stage combat and all that stuff. It just doesn't look good on camera.
Right.
What are you going to do?
Yeah.
Like, just hit me and get over with.
Sometimes you get, yeah.
Also, what really sold that one was Tom Everhart's so funny. He goes, okay, she's going to hit you, and then I want you to throw yourself over the couch, roll, and land and end up on, by that TV. Can you do that? And I went, okay.
Yeah.
So she hit me. I threw myself over the couch and rolled to the TV. It was really fun.
Yeah, I mean, it's one of the more memorable scenes of that great movie. Now, Tom Everhart, I just want to mention real quick, did he also direct you in Face Down?
Yes.
Wow, yeah.
He told me years before that, he said, I wrote this movie, and I can hear your voice in it. And I said, well, that's very flattering, but nobody's ever going to let me play the lead in a movie. You know, I just don't have the star power. You know, they want to sell movies like that, so they get a name for that. And so years later, he did it, and he said, I need you to put yourself on tape. And he didn't tell the producer that he'd written it with me in mind. He said, she has to pick you.
Oh, wow.
And, yeah, and the casting person was busy pushing everybody that she thought would be good for it. And also, we saw it in Canada, and they already had, there's a huge pressure to use Canadian actors, of course.
Yeah.
Like, J.K. Simmons is in that. He's a Canadian.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that was before he became J.K. And he was J.K. Simmons, but nobody knew. He wasn't really famous as he is now.
Yeah.
And it was a really long shot. But so I was on pins and needles, and he said, okay, she picked you. I didn't tell her, and she picked your audition tape. So.
Wow.
You're on, yeah, and he said, and I got Joe Mantegna, Adam Ant, and Peter Riegert, so I can bring you.
That's
and
awesome.
I couldn't believe it. That was unheard of. But yeah.
Well, I mean, to me personally, I mean, you say, you know, they got to bring in a big star, and I do understand that's how the business works. But when I hear Kelly Maroney's in a movie, I'm usually going to try to check that movie out. So I'm just saying.
Thank you.
From a fan's perspective, yeah, definitely. Real quick, since we don't want to hold you too long, so just try to wrap it up here. But I did want to ask you about, there's a lot of talks about remakes and so many movies are being remade, and it's, you know, I don't like it. When a movie is a hit, there's no reason.
I hate it.
Yeah, right. There's no reason to remake a hit, whether it's cult classic, critically acclaimed. Yeah. So, you're on the same page with me, I guess.
Yeah, I really hate it.
Yeah.
I mean, they Night of the Comet was passed around the studios as a remake. It really was. But what they came coming down to is, it's really a story about the girl.
Right.
You know, we could special effects and all that stuff. We kind of handled the special effects with a crummy red filter on the camera,
right,
and some dust.
Uh-huh.
I mean, that was it. What I'll say too is we had a fantastic makeup guy.
Uh-huh.
It's the same makeup guy that did Nightmare on Elm Street.
Oh, wow. Okay.
And so that's another reason to not remake it. It's already pretty much up to speed.
Right.
Where it needs to be.
Yeah.
But it's a story about the people. Don't make a lot of relationship stories these days, especially if you're going to remake something, you're going to, you know, throw a bigger budget on it. And not really necessary.
Yeah, absolutely. That's what I've been saying for a long time. And I hate when they try to mess with great movies that don't need it. So.
Thank you.
Yeah.
But I understand it. And also, people are scared to lose money, and I think that if something's already been a success, I think they stand a better chance.
Yeah, yeah.
To not get fired.
Yeah, yeah. That's so they're going to keep remaking things, but hopefully Night of the Comet and, you know, most of those great cult classics are left alone, I would hope, but we'll see, I guess.
So.
Yeah. Well, all right. Listen, Kelly, I really appreciate you doing this interview.
Well, thank you. Thank you so much. We'll have to do this again sometime.
Oh, absolutely. I would love that. So, yeah, definitely. Anything you want to plug, your Twitter, Facebook, where people can find you?
Yeah, I'm, thank you. I'm Kelly Maroney everywhere. KellyMaroney. My YouTube channel, it's a lot of stuff. I don't really understand how to use it yet, but there's clips of stuff on my YouTube channel.
Uh-huh.
And that's Loves Nerds. But you can also find it by looking up Kelly Maroney. And then I have a page on Facebook, Actress Kelly Maroney. But I try to make it always my name so that I'm easy to find. I'm on Instagram, Kelly Maroney.
Right, right.
So,
all right, so everybody check her out.
Why try to be, you know, sneaky about it?
Right, you gotta be out there for people to find you.
Yeah.
All right, well, thanks again for doing this, Kelly, and take care.
Thank you so much, and you know, send me a link to it so that I can post it.
All right, I definitely will.
All right, thank you so much, Chris.
All right, bye, Kelly.
Have a good day.
You too.